Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum students. Today we are going to discuss a very typical topic of microbiology, that is immunity. Immunity. Students, in very simple words, immunity is defined as body's defense mechanism against the invading antigens or microbes. Students, these antigens may be any type of microorganism. It may be bacteria, viruses, fungi, or even the worms, or their toxic substances which are produced by different types of bacteria. Broadly speaking, there are two main types of immunity, students. Number one, innate immunity. Innate immunity. And number two, acquired immunity. Acquired immunity. Students, first we start discussion on innate immunity. Innate immunity is defined as a type of immunity which develops in the host before the exposure of the antigen. I repeat my words, students. Innate immunity is defined as immunity which develops in the host before exposure of the antigen. Students, keep one thing in mind. Most of you people misconceive or misinterpret it as immunity which is present at the time of birth. No. Innate immunity is the immunity which is present before exposure of the antigen. Now, students, there are different components of innate immunity. And these components of innate immunity, they strengthen the innate immunity of the host. Two types of factors. Number one, factors which prevent the entry of microorganisms into the host. Factors which prevent the entry of microorganisms. Students, what are those factors? Number one, intact skin, most important. Students, intact skin, it acts as a physical barrier along with mucous membranes to prevent the entry of different microorganisms into the host. Number two, tears and bodily secretions. Students, tears and different bodily secretions. Actually, they contain a chemical substance called lysozyme. And it is because of the presence of lysozyme that the entry of microorganisms is inhibited or prevented in the host. Third component of innate immunity is, student, cilia. Students, cilia, as you know, they are hair-like structures which are present in our upper respiratory tract. As you can see, external nares, they are visible. These respiratory cilia, they prevent the entry of microorganisms. Students, other factors are acidic pH, acidic pH of stomach, acidic pH of the vagina, they prevent the entry of microorganisms. Normal flora, as you people all know, that normal flora means microorganisms which are permanent residents of different body size. And it is because of this normal flora that new invading microorganisms can't find space to habitat the host. Okay, students? Now, other types of factors which limit the growth of the microorganisms. Which limit the growth. Once or by chance, the microorganisms have breached this first component of innate immunity and they have entered the host, they are encountered by the factors of the second component. Which are those factors? These are, students, mostly the cellular components. And these cellular components, these include macrophages, neutrophils, students, macrophages and neutrophils, they actually perform the function of phagocytosis. These are the main phagocytic cells in the immune system of the body. Other cells include natural killer cells. Natural killer cells. Students, what are natural killer cells? These are specialized lymphocytes. They are larger in size than B and T lymphocytes. They are important participants of innate immunity. Dendritic cells. Dendritic cells. Dendritic cells are bone marrow derived leukocytes. They also perform the function of defending the body against the host, against the microorganisms. In addition to these cellular components, there are some also molecules which play important role in innate immunity. Students, what are those molecules which are playing important role in innate immunity? Number one, cytokines. Cytokines include interleukins, tumor necrosis factor. I have given you examples. Number two, complement proteins. Complement proteins. Number third, fever or raised body temperature. Students, actually raised body temperature or fever inhibits the growth and multiplication of microorganisms in our body. Inflammation, the process of inflammation, it is also immunogenic for us. Now, I have given you a brief review of the components of innate immunity. Students, now we move on to acquired immunity. There are two main types of acquired immunity: cell-mediated immunity, and number two, antibody-mediated immunity. Cell-mediated immunity and antibody-mediated immunity. Students, cell-mediated immunity, it is mainly active against virus-infected cells, tumor cells, and some intracellular cells. It involves two main types of cells: B and T lymphocytes. And T lymphocytes, the main portion is with T lymphocytes. T lymphocytes, as you all know, there are two parts, two components, two types: CD4 helper T cells and CD8 cytotoxic T cells. Both of these varieties of T cells, they play a vital role in cell-mediated immunity. Now, students, antibody-mediated immunity. The main participants of antibody-mediated immunity are antibodies, which are produced by plasma cells, and plasma cells are formed from the conversion of B lymphocytes. Students, in antibody-mediated immunity, the antibodies, or you can say the immunoglobulins, they along with complement proteins and neutrophils and macrophages carry out the function of body's defense. Now keep one thing in mind, students. These cell-mediated responses, antibody-mediated responses, they can play in other two types of varieties: active immunity and passive immunity. Active immunity and passive immunity. Students, what is active immunity? In very simple words, active immunity is that type of immunity which is produced in the host, or which is developed in the host through antigens. Now, this antigenic doses, it may be in the three forms. Either this antigen may be in live form, either this antigen may be in dead form, and this antigen may be in attenuated form. Attenuated means changed or altered. So, on the basis of this antigen change, scientists have prepared vaccines. What are vaccines? Vaccines are the chemical substances which actually carry out the antigen in controlled doses, in non-pathogenic doses, in smaller doses. And on the basis of different forms of antigen, vaccines can be divided into live vaccines. Live vaccines are those which carry the live microorganism, but keep one thing in mind, in smaller doses, in non-pathogenic doses, in non-virulence doses. Number two, the vaccine may be killed or dead vaccine. It contains the microorganisms which are in dead forms. And number third, attenuated vaccines, which contains the antigen or microorganisms which have been altered in their forms. Now students, we can say that active immunity is carried out in the host by the administration of vaccines. Now passive immunity. Students, passive immunity is that type of immunity which is developed in the host by the administration of already prepared antibodies. These antibodies, or you can say the immunoglobulins, they are available in the market in preformed structures. And we inject into the infected host to achieve passive immunization. Students, example of active immunization is administration of different vaccines. Let's consider an example. God forbid, any one of us might experience a road traffic accident, and after getting abrasions or skin lacerations, the consulting doctor immediately asks for injection tetanus toxoid, which is called TT injection. What is TT injection? Actually, TT injection is providing us with active immunity against the toxoid of tetanus bacteria. And if the patient appears to develop clinical signs and symptoms of tetanus disease, then the clinician immediately goes for immunoglobulins, anti-tetanus immunoglobulins. And these immunoglobulins, they are available in the market in preformed structure. So, by the administration of both injection tetanus toxoid and anti-tetanus immunoglobulins, the clinician gives both active and passive immunity to the affected or infected host. And this combination of active and passive immunization through vaccination and immunoglobulins, this combination is called passive active immunity. Okay, students? Now we go for comparison. In the last, we go for comparison of active innate immunity and acquired immunity. Okay, students, please concentrate. Number one column, innate immunity. Number two, acquired immunity. Innate immunity is also called natural immunity. Acquired immunity is also called adoptive immunity. Adoptive immunity. Number two, innate immunity is
slow in onset. Sorry, innate immunity is rapid in onset. On the other hand, acquired immunity is slow in onset. Number third, innate immunity is non-specific. Non-specific means innate immunity is effective against a wide range of microorganisms and offending antigens. On the other hand, acquired immunity is specific. Specific means that acquired immunity develops after re-exposure of the same antigen which initiated the body's immune system at first. Number four, no memory. No memory cells. On the other hand, acquired immunity has memory cells. Innate immunity, it never improves on subsequent exposures. Innate immunity, it never improves, it never increases on subsequent exposure of the antigen. On the other hand, acquired immunity, it gradually improves, increases after repeated exposure of the same antigen. Okay? Now, cellular components of innate immunity, macrophages. Natural killer cells. Dendritic cells. Neutrophils. On the other hand, the main cellular components of acquired immunity, they are B and T lymphocytes. Okay, students? And last differentiating point, molecules. In innate immunity, we see complement proteins. Cytokines. Okay? This was a brief review which compares the innate immunity and the acquired immunity. I hope you will find beneficial to this overview, and please, for details, always consult your textbooks. Thank you very much, students. Allah Hafiz.